Hi, this is Fair TV. I'm Peter Hart. Left-wing Venezuelan President Hugo Chavez died of cancer on March 5th. He had been a consistent target of harsh criticism from the U.S. corporate media. That attitude wasn't hard to spot in coverage of his passing.
Good evening. The words Venezuelan strongman so often preceded his name, and for good reason.
Many Americans viewed him as a dictator.
Of course, many Americans may have had that impression because of what they heard in the media. Chavez was a dictator, a would-be dictator, a tyrant. One of the most bizarre takes on Chavez, though, came from the Associated Press, which argued that Chavez squandered his country's oil wealth. Chavez invested Venezuela's oil wealth into social programs, including state-run food markets, cash benefits for poor families, free health clinics, and education programs. But those gains were meager compared with the spectacular construction projects that oil riches spurred in glittering Middle Eastern cities, including the world's tallest building in Dubai and plans for branches of the Louvre and Guggenheim museums in Abu Dhabi. Indeed, what kind of monster chooses the welfare of his people over lavish monuments? But seriously, since 2003, following a ruinous strike by Venezuelan oil managers, the country has cut poverty by 50%, extreme poverty by 70%, and has made great leaps in healthcare and education, all while posting strong economic growth. Of course, during this time, the number of Venezuelans living in the world's tallest building went from zero to zero, and the number of copies of the Mona Lisa remained flat at none. Can you threaten to start a war to stop something that doesn't exist? Open the new issue of Time magazine and you'll see the headline, "The Path to War: Inside Barack Obama's Struggle to Stop an Iranian Nuke." This piece is a behind-the-scenes peek at the debate inside the White House about the steps the United States is willing to take to stop Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. That notion is repeated throughout. We're even told that Obama, quote, offered to let Iran keep a peaceful nuclear program, but Iran's leaders rebuffed Obama's efforts, close quote. But nowhere in the piece is it noted that there is no evidence that Iran is actually pursuing a nuclear weapon. Regular inspections of the country have failed to turn up any evidence of that. Instead, though, we read things like this, quote, Iran itself has slowed down its efforts, converting some enriched uranium to a form that can be used only in research, not in weapons, close quote. This is treated as evidence that Iran is moving toward its weapon more slowly. This is alarming, especially since the article is about whether the United States will launch a military attack on Iran. Time ominously warns that time is running out and that Obama will soon face the hardest decision of his presidency. Time faces a decision, too, whether or not it wants to repeat the mistakes of the Iraq War. And finally, the State Department's recent draft assessment of the Keystone XL pipeline's environmental impact got some media attention. How it was covered on one show said quite a bit, not about the pipeline so much, but about the corporate media. The roundtable discussion on ABC's This Week on March 3rd was unsurprisingly tilted to the right. Three conservatives, Cokie Roberts, and as the nominal and outnumbered left, Democratic advisor James Carville. He's the one who brought up Keystone, but his message was a little hard to follow. He declared that the State Department report meant that the pipeline was likely to be built and that environmentalists would not be pleased. His actual message seemed to be this.
Look, if you're a Democrat and would you believe in science, then if this is the science, that's the science.
Of course, there's no reason to accept that a State Department review is the science on anything, which is why we have seen an array of groups issuing critical responses to this report, which argues that the pipeline won't exacerbate climate change because the tar sands are going to be burnt anyway, which is not really a scientific analysis, but a political judgment, and a questionable one. But viewers can't hear that point of view in a TV debate, even from the person hired to play the left. I'm Peter Hart. Thanks for tuning in to Fair TV.